and Good Grief Worldwide proudly present Grief Diaries, hosted by Linda Sheldolin Fell and Angie Cartwright. Grief Diaries candidly discusses grief, uncensored, as we explore our losses, journeys, hearts, and hope for grievers everywhere. To listen to archived episodes, visit www.griefdiaries.com. And now, your hosts, Linda Sheldolin Fell and Angie Cartwright.
Well, hello, everyone, and welcome to Grief Diaries Radio, an inspiring radio show where everyone, where we sit, talk, and share losses, journeys, and hearts to offer comfort and inspire hope to those in need. Say a big hello to my beautiful co-host, Angie Cartwright. Hello, Angie.
Good evening, Linda.
So tonight's guest is Angela Alexander, a beautiful, beautiful lady, a mother of four who had just arrived in Japan in the spring of 2000 as part of her Air Force deployment when she was unexpectedly summoned into her captain's office with tragic news that her husband's car, carrying him and their four children, fell off an overpass in California, landing upside down on top of a parked car, people inside. That freak accident claimed the lives of Angela's 2 8-year-old sons. And tonight she shares with us how she faced the journey and then found, almost supernaturally, this is so cool, and I can't wait to hear about this. She found, after the accident, individual letters from her sons that sustained her faith and helped to create the ministry that she leads today called Miracles in Action. So welcome to Grief Diaries Radio, Angela. It's wonderful to have you with us tonight.
It's wonderful to be here, Linda and Angie. Appreciate you inviting me.
You know, first off, I'm so very, very sorry about the accident that happened in 2000. You know, all of us that tune into the show are grievers on some level. And when you lose a child, that is unspeakable, and you lost not one but two. And were your sons twins?
No, actually, out of the four children, two were biological and two were foster children. So the two boys, Maurice was my biological son, and Roger, he was my foster son, but they were both 8 years old at the time of the car crash.
Okay. Okay. And you were far, far away in Japan.
Yes.
Take us back to that moment. And the reason why I always start there is so you can walk us through the journey that brings you to where you are today. You were thousands of miles away when you were asked to come into your captain's office. What happened?
I was on the other side of the world. I was in Japan on military duty. I had just gotten there 3 days prior. I'm a reservist in the Air Force, and we were only supposed to be there 2 weeks. I was only supposed to be, you know, we work 1 week in a month and 2 weeks out of the year. So I had just arrived in Japan, and I was working with a group of people, and Lieutenant Mavechi came up to me and said, Angela, I need to speak with you. Well, immediately my guards went up because it was April Fool's weekend, and everybody was doing all these practical jokes all over the place, and I was like, why are you calling me out? And so we just start walking and talking about nothing, and we end up at the door of this small office, and inside was a man who was introduced as a priest and another lady from my unit. Mm. And the priest was nervously shaking, holding this paperwork from the Red Cross. And he said, Angela, your family has been in a car accident. And from the looks on their faces, I knew this was no April Fool's joke.
All right.
And then what happened was the day before, my husband and four children were driving down the highway here in California, and a car cut them off. Our truck hit the center divider, and upon impact, they were all knocked unconscious. And then our truck went backwards across that highway and fell 25 feet below and landed upside down on top of two other parked vehicles with people inside. Praise God, our car fell on their engine and not the roof. So they were extremely shaken up, but they were okay. But as you said, my 2 8-year-old sons passed instantly at the scene. And I'm in Japan. So since then, I have retired from the Air Force and wrote my autobiography, Miracles in Action. And it's titled that because although Maurice and Roger died instantly, God allowed both of them to write and leave behind these incredible goodbye letters. Mm.
And that's
Maurice
amazing.
Didn't know about Roger's letter. Yes, Maurice didn't know about Roger's letter, and Roger didn't know about Maurice's letter. And what happened was, after they told me what happened, I had left the next day. I was on a plane ride back to the United States, and I recalled this letter Maurice had written about a month before the car crash. So he was 8 years old in the third grade. Maurice had a math test at school. He finished his test early, received his A. So now he has to be quiet while his classmates completed their test, right? And so in that quiet time, he wrote this letter to me and my husband. And he had never written us a letter before. So
wow.
Never. And so he ran in the house from school that afternoon. He shouted, "Mommy, Mommy, Daddy, Daddy, I wrote your letter. And I said, I looked at him and I said, "What do you mean you wrote us a letter? Where are you going?" And he said, "Nowhere, Mommy, I love you."
Oh, my goodness.
I know. And I looked at my husband and said, "Baby, get the checkbook, because whatever brother wants, the mother can have." And we sat at the foot of our bed, and we read his letter aloud. And he wrote 3 pages. He not only expressed that he loved us, he explained why he loved us.
Oh, wow.
And at the end of all 3 pages, he said, "Bye-bye."
Really?
And I'm telling you. And the letter was just so it was so important to me why he was alive. I mean, I called my mom, I called my family. I said, "Look, listen, let me read this letter Maurice wrote." And we were just so excited. And I said, "I'm going to frame your letter, Maurice." He was just so thrilled that we did. To him, it was like, "Oh, Mama just wrote your letter." But we didn't realize, it wasn't until after he passed away that I could see God's handprint all throughout the letter.
Mm-hmm.
And I understand why God didn't allow me to see that prior, because I would have been AWOL. I wouldn't have went to Japan. We would have been on, lockdown. And
right.
I would have tried to stop what was in action. And so, sometimes God has to just hide things from us for a minute until we can handle, until he's ready to reveal his purpose. So
absolutely.
That's how we received Maurice's letter. And then the Thursday before their double memorial service, I was praying in my kitchen, and I said, "Dear God, thank you so much for Maurice's letter. It's truly the reason I can stand here right now." And I said, "But I need to know that Roger's at peace."
Yeah.
And God laid one word on my heart, and he said, "Search." I was like, "Search?" It didn't make no sense to anybody, not even me. But I searched my house for over 3 hours that afternoon and didn't find anything that gave me the peace that I had prayed for. But that evening was open house at all four of my children's elementary school. And at this point in time, my husband, he's still in the hospital. And my girls, they needed some normalcy in their life. Their friends on the block, they was going to open house. I said, "You know what, girls? We're going to go as well." And we left a house full of people. And we went to all of their classes. And finally, we got to Roger's second grade classroom. And I walked in, and I spoke to Mrs. Blassie, his teacher, and I asked, like all the other parents, "What did my son do for open house?" Now, 2 weeks before the car crash, Mrs. Blassie had given all of her second graders all kind of arts and craft supplies and said, "Do something for open house. Your parents are coming." With no other instructions, they could do anything they wanted to do. And Roger cut out the shape of a house with closed doors. And when you opened it up, it said, "I have a big backyard and a big house." And he just started describing heaven. And I knew this is exactly what I had been praying and searching for. And it is kind of really hard to explain Rogers, because he did a lot in Crayolas and in creative, but it's just beautiful what he put together. And I almost fell to my knees as I praised God for being so good to me, because I had just prayed hours early that day, "I need to know that Rogers at peace." And this is what God gave me that evening.
He answered.
Mm. Wow.
He answered. I'm speechless.
I just got goosebumps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
And then while I was writing the memorial program, that's when God said, "Angela, yes, their letters were written to soothe your soul, but more importantly, to share."
Yeah, it's just maybe soothe other souls.
Right, to soothe right. other souls. But I wish my testimony was I was obedient right away. But for months I walked in disobedient because I didn't have a clue how to do what God wanted me to do.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, after 6 months, after I was in agony, you know, when God tells you to do something, you don't do it, that don't feel good.
So
finally, after 6 months, I woke up and I said, I surrender all. And I started writing my autobiography.
Mm. So wow.
That was my transition from military to ministry.
And so,
you know, it's like a 5-year span, but that's in a nutshell right there.
And so you launched your book, Miracles in Action. And you now have a film that is being done about your journey.
How exciting is that?
That is, well, look at Heaven is for Real, Pastor Burpo, you know, and that's a fantastic movie. So now yours is the next one that we'll be watching on the big screen. And, you know, that's fantastic because what happens when you share your story with people, it helps mm-hmm. them, it comforts them, and then that lifts your own heart. So, you know, congratulations on that. That's an incredible gift that you're giving so many. So you will be 15 years in to your journey on April Fool's of this year. How's your family doing? How's your family doing?
You know, in the beginning, my daughter, Angela, who was 11 years old at the time, she was really angry. I remember her, she wrote a poem called Why is the Sky Still Blue? You know? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Why does the world still move? Yeah.
Hello. Yes. She couldn't understand. Mm-hmm. And what made her even angrier was when she would hear me testify how good God is. That infuriated her. And because she couldn't see the miracle that was in action. That I, Maurice and Roger's letters were almost like to me and my husband. And she couldn't see that. So it took her a long time, and she was mad when I didn't come to her pity party. And I was, and you know, we're both two determined women now. But I was like, hey, you're going to get on my train to get out the way. I'm not going to your pity party. And for a while, she wasn't coming to my celebration. And and so
I love that.
right. So by pure, she just got tired. And so she finally surrendered and said, okay, I'll search for the miracle in action. She surrendered after a while. But now she's doing fantastic. She graduated from college, and she has a wonderful job she loves in Los Angeles. So she's doing good. And my husband, oh, that's a whole other story. At the time of the car crash, the beauty about all of this was when our car went over the highway, because they were already knocked unconscious, they have no memory. So they had no nightmares. And so when my husband was released from the hospital, he used to ask me every night, what happened?
Yeah.
You know, if I had just went a different direction, our sons would be here. If I had just left 5 minutes later, you know, he was just so, because he was a driver, even though it wasn't his fault.
Survivor's guilt, right.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And he had vehicular slaughter charges pending against him for like a month while they were going through the investigation. And it was just one thing after another, and every night he would just ask me what happened. And, of course, you know, at the time I was in Japan, so all I had was the police report and the medical report. So all I did every night for about 30 days, I read Maurice's letter to him. I read Roger's letter to him. And I said, Siri, that's my husband's name, there is nothing you could have done differently that day. The miracle was already in action. The letters were already written. And you know, that just kind of, you know, just kind of just soothed him, because that guilt was heavy. And all he wanted to do was trade places with them. And that was so painful that he had a hole in his heart that I could not reach. Only God could fill that hole.
Right.
And God did. He did.
You know, and men also grieve differently than women. So in addition to the survivor's guilt that he faced following the accident, he also is a man, and they're just wired different. And,
right.
you know, that's a whole, they see it through different filters and perspective. Just like your daughter, she saw it through the eyes of an 11-year-old.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, not able to see any of the blessings that come from it. You know, I received a letter from someone who over 40 years ago was 10 years old when she lost a brother, a teenage brother. And it was very interesting in her reflection of looking back on her 10-year-old self of, you know, what happened. And so you had two daughters in the car. How's your other daughter?
My other daughter, her name was Angelina. She was 10 years old at the time, so now I think she's 25. And so she was my foster daughter. So now how she handled it at that time, she pretended that Maurice and Roger were still alive.
Mm-hmm.
That's how she handled it. And,
right.
And I made it a point in the house to continue to talk about them.
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, I didn't want to, you know, hush, you know, sometimes I hear people, you know, just act like, pretend like they never existed. However, Angelina, she pretended that they were still alive. And so that became, it was okay at first, but it started to, when she's like, oh, we can't leave, Roger's not in the car. she's
right.
To the point that she was like invisible, like they were invisible. And
okay.
So we had to, you know, that was okay for a minute. We had to, reel her back in and cope with it. But she's doing great now. She's, you know, she, of course, she's aged out of the foster care system, and she has a beautiful family of her own now. So she's doing great.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Fantastic. And so, you know, did the foster care system, did they provide support, counseling, you know, for the foster daughter, but
not
your biological?
It was mandatory.
Okay.
It was mandatory, yeah.
Fantastic. Fantastic. And are you still a foster family?
I'm not a foster family anymore. I'm an adopted mother. So it's even better. 3 years after Maurice and Roger passed away, Siri, he just still had this hole in his heart, and we were no longer a long-term foster family, because by this time I had accepted my ministry. I was writing my autobiography. And when you're a foster parent, when they come to you, they've seen some things, they've heard some things, and they need your attention. And I knew I didn't have that to give to a foster child anymore because I was, you know, taking on this autobiography. And so we had shared with our foster agency that we were a respite care family now, so we would take children on an emergency basis. So one day, 3 years later, my social worker called, and she says, Angela, we have this little girl who needs a home. And I said, oh, no, you know. And she says, oh, please. You know, she set me up. She said, oh, please. And I said, well, you know, what's the emergency? And she said, I asked, well, how old is the little girl? Is she old enough to go to school where I can still have my days free? She says, oh, no, she's 14 months. I said, what? Now, by this time, Linda and Angie, my daughter, my name was Angela. My biological daughter name is Angela, and Angela is 14 years old at this point. And she comes telling me this baby is 14 months old. I said, no way. Oh, please. I said, no way. And then I said, well, what's the emergency? And she said, oh, well, her mother, her foster mother, because she's already in the foster care system, her foster mother is having a complicated pregnancy and cannot lift over 10 pounds. I said, oh, you're really pulling at my heartstring, but that would be a no. Oh, I don't know what I'm going to do. Please. Can we negotiate? I said, 14. No, I said, we can't negotiate because she's going to be 14 months all day today. That is unchangeable. That is non-negotiable.
Oh, goodness.
And she said, well, can we go to Plan B? And I said, what's that? She said, can she come over for 3 days till I find a long-term placement? I said, sure. That's what I do, respite care. But pick her up. Make sure you pick up Thursday by 12 because I have a very important 2 o'clock appointment. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. She thanked me profusely. And then she said, I'll bring Angela over tomorrow. And I said, what'd you say? Back that name up? She said, oh, I didn't tell you her name is Angela. I said, her name is not Angela. Yes, it is. No, it's not. Yes, it is. We went back and forth. And I said, yes, okay, you bring Miss Angela over tomorrow. And let me tell you, so out of all the names in the world, her name is Angela. And out of all the days out of the year, she was placed in our home on the 3rd anniversary of Maurice and Roger's passing, April 1st, 2003. So with those two major miracles, we began adoption paperwork the very next day.
Is that right?
That is true. Miracles are in action. So now she's 13.
I have to ask. Did you change her name?
No. Her name was already Angela. I get that question all the time. I would not do to, because she was already 14 months. That's how I let me know. Because, you know, we ask God for signs and wonders. And, you know, when you go from foster to adoption, that is huge. Because, you know, when you're a foster mother, you can get the child back because it's Tuesday. No questions asked. But when you adopt, they don't even give you a number to call.
Right. Right, it's a done deal.
You cannot, once that judge say that baby is yours, bye.
Right.
So it's a huge deal. It's a huge deal. So God had to bring me great signs and wonders to let me know that she was my baby and to go to that next step of adoption.
And so how did that help your husband?
Tremendously. And it also, and I do believe that babies have prayers too, because baby Angela, she was removed from her mother, her biological mother, at 6 months old. And by the time we received her, she was already her 3rd foster family. So, I said, you know, baby has prayers too. Can you imagine being 1 year old and just waking up with another house, another family, different smells, different nationality, different foods, and don't know what happened to the people you saw yesterday? And don't have the communication, not able to ask, you know, and scared that you might wake up tomorrow and be a whole nother family.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
you know, Angela, you know, Angie's name is Angela, right?
My legal name is Angela.
Part of her childhood in the foster care system.
Really?
Yep. Oh, yeah. Yep. From a very young age.
You're sharing my story. Amen.
Right. Yeah.
So she was one of those. And that's something that she speaks on is being in the foster care system and, you know, what it's like.
I would love to hear you.
You know, what it's like to, and that, because that is a form of grief,
is
people who have been through the foster care system and what it's like to have that strange car. And Angie, you've actually talked about it on the show at different points, having that strange car show up in your driveway, and you knew who it was because it was a nice car.
It was time to go. And as I got older, probably 11 or 12, I started running from those cars because I knew what was going to happen, you know. It's really, you know, and it is grief. And I've learned later in my healing journey that I grieved as a child from get go. But that you would think a child who lived in those conditions would want you to go. You would be in their car in 2.5 seconds, say, please take me from here. And that was not my experience, because if that's all you've ever known, is that, you know, those surroundings, when you come to get that, you know, they're the enemy. And really what they're trying to do is get me to safety and to security. And then I also had experiences with bad foster homes and then just amazing foster homes. So, I grew up in the system until I was 18 years old. The short version.
Right.
Very short version.
Because even if you're in a, you know, so-called bad foster home, you kind of don't want to leave because you're afraid of the unknown. It could be worse.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, or to say anything, because you learn a lot of things about bad things, that those things you just don't talk about. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And foster families get such a bad rap. We do.
And there were some amazing. I always try to do that. I always try to make sure that I speak about the amazing foster homes that just really changed my life. And, were, you know, and my best friend they won foster parents twice, 2 years in a row, and they and they're no longer a practice. You know, they don't no longer do it, but the kids don't stop coming.
Right,
the
right,
houses
right.
are still full, and they feed everybody, you know, and they're amazing people.
Yeah. Yeah, and actually, you know, I disagree. I think, you know, most of the foster homes out there have the very best of intentions, but just like anything
yep.
and anyone, there can be the bad apple
just
in
anything.
Every bushel.
Yeah, exactly.
And yeah, yeah, and you know, I have dear friends that have been a wonderful foster home for 10 years, and
mm-hmm.
they love those children very much. They have three biological daughters of their own, and the whole family is very involved in all the children that come to their home. And they've also done respite. Yeah, so I really, my hat's off to all of those people that open
yes.
their home up as a foster family for children in need.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's an amazing gift that you give a young life. That's just fantastic. So, Angela, you're now, you know, you've got your ministry going and cool things are happening with your film and such. You also have a free ebook for people that visit your website, which is miraclesinaction.com. And that free ebook is called 7 Steps from Grief to Peace. Can you tell us about it?
7 Steps from Grief to Peace. You know, after my son's passed, I would get questions like, what did you do, from other people who are grieving, what did you do the week after your son's passed? What did you do the month after they passed? What did you do after everybody left? What was going on? How did you wake up the next morning? You know,
mm-hmm.
all those questions, after question, and, you know, just like a store, you know, your customers will tell you what to sell. And after I kept getting all those questions, I said, you know what, let me just put these questions in a book and share with people my personal 7 steps from grief to peace. And so that's how the ebook
right.
came about. And anybody
okay.
and everybody can receive that if you go to miraclesinaction.com, and if you opt in, you will receive that gift.
Okay,
awesome.
Wonderful. And so you did that pretty early on then, or was that something that evolved later?
A whole lot later. Actually, that book just came out like last year.
Two years ago.
Sure,
okay.
recently.
Okay.
And I have a workbook that came out like 2 or 3 years ago.
Okay. So you continue
yeah.
to find things on your heart that you want to put out there for those that are walking their own journey. And
yes, as
you know,
I evolve, I bring people with me.
Right,
right.
And I think what's so important about that is, you know, grievers who don't have a lot of support around them, they feel very alone. And
mm.
it feels, you know, very crushing and overwhelming and dark. And so when mm. you have someone else such as yourself, Angela, that have been through it and you are a testament to survival and here you are finding joy in life and doing things that are wonderful, that lift your heart and touch the lives of others around you, you know, it gives them hope that their own journey is survivable. And, you know, in going back to your own tragedy, when did you feel the hope pretty early in, or was that, you know, what was your journey like there?
You know what? And this is kind of hard to explain, but God gave me instantaneous peace. Now, if you had asked me the day before, what would you do if something happened to your children? I remember answering that question. I would go crazy, hook up the IV, I'm through. And when I was told, I couldn't believe how at peace I was. And to the point that on that plane ride coming back from Japan, I kept pinching myself. I couldn't believe that I still knew the alphabet. I was
right.
reciting in my head on that plane, right, A, B, C, D. I couldn't believe I still knew the date. And I couldn't believe that I didn't go crazy as self-predicted. And I didn't understand that. Now I understand it, because if I had gone crazy, I would have come home and I would have taken my girls and my husband down with me.
Mm-hmm.
This ministry wouldn't have been birthed.
Mm-hmm.
And God saw the ending and knew that I need to have my mind intact so that because due to my son's passing, this ministry was birthed. But if I had gone crazy, then that wouldn't have happened. So God stepped in, interceded, and gave me instantaneous peace. And you know that phrase, I've heard my whole life, that peace that surpasses your understanding. I read it, I heard it, but I never experienced that peace until that moment.
Wow.
So do you ever feel like you were able to authenticate your own grief? Or do you feel like you sidestepped the grief or escaped the grief or somehow was spared the grief?
I went through every page of grief when I wrote that autobiography. Every page, every step. Writing that book was so therapeutic for me because I started when I was a little girl, and when I stepped back and looked at all the pages, I said, oh, that's why I went through that when I was 10 years old.
Right.
That prepared me for what happened when I was 16. That prepared me for what happened when I was 25. And I was able to go through and see how God orchestrated my whole life.
Mm.
And I say, you know, April 1st, 2000, that was the day my faith was revealed, not built. God had been building and constructing my faith my whole life. So on that day, I could receive the peace that he
right.
gave me.
And so
I like
for
to share, Linda, I'd like to share that you know, and thank you for sharing that, Angela, because Linda, I know you've heard this already, but I often share that there was a moment in time, and I've had many losses in my life, you know, not all at once, but spread over a span of my life, and there was a moment of clarity. Some people call it a spiritual awakening. There's many names for it, but I had a moment of clarity that has not changed. I cannot give you the specific date because it was after my mom's drug overdose when she died in 2010. But I was down on my knees in that dark space, in that dark place, and I was just crying out to my creator and saying, God, what do you want from me? Of course, there's a few curse words in there. I ain't going to lie. And I'm just saying, you know, there was some bleeps and, you know, and tears, and it was just, you know, and Linda talks about wailing, and I said, what do you want from me? And I'm not a person that says there's this and that's God and there's this and that's, you know, that's just not who I am. That's another show in itself. But what I do know is that there was that time and in that day and on my knees in that moment, I knew why everything had been where it was, why everything had happened, what I was supposed to do with it, and what I was born to do
Amen.
With it. And you know what? I am so blessed to have that. And so what do we say, Angela, to people who many, 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 many do not get stuff like that? They don't. What do you say to that? Do you say, you know, to me what comes to my heart is keep seeking.
Right.
You know, that's seeking and you will find. And prior to me in that moment, you know, I was seeking, meaning reading a book, doing this, looking at this. If this didn't fit, I didn't apply it. If that worked, yes. You know, and I was in the libraries, and I was with the ministers, and I just went everywhere and
right.
did what I could. So what would be your answer to those that are struggling, who don't have that moment, that say, this is it. This is
right.
what I know to do, you know?
Right. Well, personally for me, God is the source of my strength.
Right.
But we
do know people struggle with that in itself.
Right. Right.
So.
And a lot of people give up. You know, you can walk the talk a lot of times when something happens. You know, everybody
right.
can praise God when everything is great, but let something happen. Are you still
yeah,
walking
yeah.
the talk?
Yeah, yeah, you take it
or
away
you
from me.
Away.
Let me tell you, let me show you my faith in at that time. Right.
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 Right. So for people who have walked away from God, I would just say search for your miracles. And the more miracles you search for, the more miracles you find. The more miracles, the alternative is to search for your misery. And we don't want to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So search for your miracles and, you know, and just search and focus on the focus on the good things that's going on in your life. And if the more you focus on that, the more you see and the bigger those good things will get.
Right.
You know, for me, that's how you turn your grief into peace and your pain into power. That's how you turn your mourning into good mourning and your grief into good grief.
Right.
That's very, very true. But how do you give – what first step? Because many people, they
mm-hmm.
are not able to see the sunrise. They're grasping for the straws of hope. So what
maybe
is the
they're
first
not there
step?
Yet.
What is the yeah. first step that you offer someone
when they look at us,
you know, because they'll look at us kind of skeptical and disbelief. And so what would be that first step?
Well, the first step in Seven Steps from Grief to Peace, the first step is ask God to heal your broken heart. That's the first step, is to give it to God. And mm-hmm. I don't have an alternative route. You know, I'm just saying that's my journey. That I understand Miracles in Action and Seven Steps from Grief to Peace was written. It's a personal journey. So this is the route God had me go. And I know
sure.
this is not the route for every single body. So
right,
I don't
right.
have all the answers if you don't go, you know, the route I went. However, there's many routes to peace.
Exactly.
So, yeah, so, I mean, if it's meditating, if it's listening to inspirational music, if it's going out for a walk, you know, sometimes just going out, you know, don't become homebound. Just go out for a walk. I clearly remember when our sons passed away, Sari and I, we would just go to the gym and just walk on the treadmill with tears just going down our faces. And we'll just
right.
be holding on to that treadmill and just walking, and just walking because, you know, that gives off another chemical in your body that just makes you feel better.
Right.
Just go outside mm-hmm. in the sun. You know, if you need to go to a grief group or, you know, or individual counseling, something so you won't become homebound and start, you know, dwelling down to self-pity
mm-hmm.
and just become withdrawn. We don't want that. And that's when all the seven steps, you know, of grief set in.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't want that, the depression and all that. We don't want that to set in and just last for years to lifetime.
Right.
And
what I share with people, they say, oh, you know, in time, first of all, grief has no time span. Let's just put that on the record. Grief has no time span. And time does not heal grief. Time, because I've seen people in grief for a long time. So time alone does not heal.
What we do in the time.
But you do need time to heal. But time all by itself is not the answer.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Beautifully said. I love, you know, your offers of suggestions to people that, you know, get them out of that, you know, get them moving of, you know, getting on a treadmill, even with tears running down your face.
Yes.
You're on that treadmill and you're moving and such. Did you ever have moments of anger?
Not anger. I have moments where I just miss my son so terribly that I could, you know, I'm having a moment.
Right.
You know, because not only do I miss my 8-year-old sons at that time, but I miss the men they would be today.
Yeah,
right.
Grandchildren. You all told me you have grandbabies. I miss the grandbabies that I would have today.
Right.
You know, I miss my daughter-in-law. My son Maurice. He was a lover. I know he would be married by now.
Right.
I know he would. You know, because he would be 24, 25 years old. Yeah, he'd be married. And so, but I miss my daughter-in-law that I never got a chance to meet.
Yeah.
So
right.
it's not only the past, but it's the future that we didn't get a chance to experience. That aches my heart.
So there are times, I'll ask you, Angela, there are times when, and Linda and I talk about it on the show, we all have, you know, I like how you made sure you said, this is my experience, this is my journey, and I only wish to pass it on to you, and everybody does it differently, but so when everybody sees things differently, and we all, and I think that's what makes the world go round, don't you? I mean, because your story is going to touch somebody that maybe I can't touch.
Exactly.
And I really honor your story and thank you for sharing it. But, you know, there are those times when, because we have a lot, I mean, that's what we do. We have grievers. Those are our audiences. We have people who are maybe, well, you know, 7 days into block, you know, burying a child. And, you know, I am one that speaks very openly and candidly and bluntly about grief. And one of the quotes I have is that I said that grief is not self-pity. Grieving is not self-pity. When we are knocked out and we can't breathe and we are just, you know, the life's been knocked out of us, So can you define maybe what you're talking about a little bit more there? Because I'm not dishonoring what you feel that was for you. Because like I said, everybody's different. But I can say, even live on the radio tonight, that after 10 years, after my husband was killed in the wreck that we were both involved in, there was some very unhealthy grieving going on for me. And I was using drinking, alcohol, you know, alcohol, chemicals. I wasn't accepting any help whatsoever. 10 years is a long time to grieve. And what happened at the end of that 10 years was nothing but more grief. And so I can tell you that I think there was some self-pity going on there. But I did find out is that grievers live in a world that do not know, you know, we don't have a world that understands them. Now we do more than we ever have. You know, you're out doing the work, talking openly about it. Thank you for doing that. Grief was not talked about in 1996 like it is today.
Right.
So could you go back and say, what would you tell a mom tonight if it's been 8 days since you buried a child? Is she in self-pity or is she doing what naturally she needs to do?
You know, grief is real and is raw. And although God gave me instantaneous peace with my sons, 4 years prior to my son's passing, my sister died.
Okay, so you have more lost prior to that, okay.
And my sister died, I literally felt my heart break into a million little pieces.
Right, right.
I had never felt my heart before, and I felt it break into a million little pieces. And I'm telling you, I was in so much physical and spiritual and emotional pain that I didn't even know
right. What
day it was.
Exactly.
For over a year, I used to drive aimlessly down the highway and didn't even know where I was.
Right.
So that is real. I've been on both spectrums of the
scale.
All
those. Right.
I went to extreme pain to instantaneous peace. And so I will never say I know how somebody feels, because some days I don't even know how I feel. So how are you going to know how I feel? You know,
amen.
People, I know how you, you know, I know how,
sometimes
how
you want to go, really? Are you serious?
Yeah.
If you knew, you'd run.
Say, oh, I know how you feel. I said, well, can you please tell me? Because I don't have a clue.
Right? We were talking a little bit about that before the show. Yes.
Right.
Yes.
I know how you
well,
feel.
Well, thank you for
you
sharing
do?
That, because the more, and, you know, one of the things Linda and I wanted to do with this radio show was not only bring in healers such as yourself and let the world know there's hope, you know, and there's so many different ways in, meaning spiritually, however you want to look at it, there's hope. You know, we get emails, you know, how do I do this? How do I do that? And we don't know which person who comes on the show is going to be the one that they hear that message that Wednesday night. So thank
right.
you for opening up a little bit more. But we always talk about the deeper, darker part of grief, because a lot of times we have a lot of listeners that are really raw and really fresh into their grief, and they may not be able to do your step one.
Right.
So if they're not at step one, what would be previous to that? What was before step one? Because I know I have a grief diary book me and Linda wrote, and we have directions on how to, you know, feel a little bit better. But there was stuff we did before that.
And you know, also helps. Humor heals. Humor heals. Go if you got to go to the store and get, you know, the whole series of I Love Lucy, something just
oh,
to
I
make
love it.
You, that's my favorite. Something just to make you laugh. That also
cry.
Brings up a chemical
laugh.
That makes you feel good. Laughter, humor heals. And if you can't
you know,
find anybody around you to give a good joke, go get you a video and sit down with some popcorn and your favorite meal and just have you a good belly laugh and laugh to
good.
I Love Lucy or whatever tickles your fancy.
You know, that's beautiful, because one of the speakers
really
at the convention is award-winning playwright and comedian Carol Scabelli. And every so often I hear someone says, you know, well, how can a grief convention possibly be fun?
Yes.
And
yeah.
yet, you know, Friday night, we've got a beautiful evening planned out featuring one of two people, Carol Scabelli being one of them. And she's hysterical, a lovely, lovely lady, very talented lady who feels that when you're grieving, it's the right time to bring in humor.
I've heard her, Angela, and let me tell you, she's hilarious.
She's funny.
And sometimes
people who are grieving, they need permission to laugh.
They do.
Yes. Yes.
They feel
give yourself permission to rent a movie and have laughter in your life, or give yourself permission to get a big popcorn and a big thing of cheesecake and watch a show and cry all your tears out. You want
right.
wear sweat and just let it out. What do you think of that idea?
I love it because, you know, and sometimes people feel like they have to walk around with this cloth of grief, you know, and that's
yes.
back in the old days when you had to wear 30 days black.
Yes.
And, you know, they feel like they're not honoring their loved one. And I just share people, you know, the healing of your broken heart is no indication that you no longer love your loved one.
Amen.
That's
Amen.
Not an indication. It's okay to heal. They want you to heal. They will not want you to be here in misery.
That's
Search
right.
for
yeah,
the
there's a fear. There's a fear that exists, and there I can relate to it, that I had a fear that if I started feeling better, there was going to be
forget.
A disconnection from my loved ones. And, you know, I think I got that. I have no idea where it came from. And I even looked at that. Where did that come from, Angie? You know, where did you get that idea? And I don't know where I got it. I'm not going to blame it from anybody, but I know the day that I released it, I said, you know, there was a day that I was able to say I can take him with me wherever I go.
Amen.
And it was a day of freedom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it truly is. And, you know, I did a blog a while back that am I cheating on my grief when I dance with joy? And, you know, it's exactly that. It's when we have moments of joy, they're hard-earned and hard-fought for, and they balance out the sadness in our heart. Our heart can hold both. And so it's really, really important
exactly.
that we create those moments of joy to balance out mm-hmm. the sadness.
And
I love Lucy analogy because, you know,
I love Lucy, literally. I love her. I love her show, so.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's a great, great tool to offer grievers.
It's not fair to your children who survive that you passed away along with your child who passed away, because that's basically, you know, you're just a walking dead if you totally gave
mm-hmm.
up. And your children who, you know, my girls who survived, your children who survived, they need their mother, they need their father.
Right.
But you need to be present for them.
Mm-hmm.
Right, right.
You
and you hear
yourself.
That. You know, you hear people, as a grieving mother, you hear people that say, you know, but you have to do it for your family. And that's a tough one because,
that is.
In my personal opinion, that almost puts on another layer of guilt.
Right.
You know, when you're trying to find your footing, it's truly, you cannot help your family until you help yourself first. And that is very, very important. And,
mm-hmm.
You know, but again, as you've said, it's very important to, you know, find the tools that work for you. And there's many grief tools out there. I Love Lucy is a fantastic suggestion. And we will forever credit you with that that beautiful tool. And because
well, not only the tool of that, but the tool of empowerment. When I think of empowerment, I'm thinking of Angela right now. Whole week, that's what I'm going to think. Empowerment Angela. Yeah,
yeah,
that's what I'm feeling for you, from you.
Angela
yeah.
Alexander, because you are, your power comes through loud and clear, and that's a beautiful, beautiful thing.
Mm-hmm.
And you can turn, you can harness the pain and turn it into power. Angie and I have also done that. So the three
mm-hmm.
of us are examples that it can be done. And so, because when you have one person, they say, oh, well, she's, you know, she's unique or this or that. Well, here's three. And
exactly.
it can be done. We are living proof of that. And is it easy? No, we didn't say it was easy. But,
it,
you know, we're here to tell you that grief is survivable. And here's what we've done to survive that grief. And,
right.
you know, so Angela, you know, thank you for sharing your ministry with us. And, you know, you've got an amazing story. You know, it's tragic, but your journey to the other side and what you've done, you know, you've come out of the ashes to create
mm-hmm.
something that touches the lives of others in a very profound way. Where, what all are you doing with your ministry right now? We've got just a few minutes left, so I want to make sure that we, you know, feature all the cool things that you're doing.
I'm speaking. I speak at different churches, retreat, conference, book clubs, women fellowships. You know, the documentary will be out. The premiere is next month. I'm excited about that. But we're also, God gave me a vision of a movie, so I'm trusting and believing that will come to pass, to fruition soon after the documentary. So a lot is on my plate. I'm looking forward to it, and I'm just excited for the doors that's being opened. And I'm excited that I used to hear the phrase all the time, the death of your child is the worst thing that could ever happen to you. Well, I'm so glad that that's not, you know, if you don't allow it to be, it will not. And it all starts, mm-hmm. it all starts in your mind.
Well, you know, again, it's life-changing, yes, but there are blessings in everything, including tragedies. And you just have to have your heart open to it. And it takes time to allow your heart to be open that. You found that inspiration pretty early on, and that's fantastic. But it's open to everybody at some point on their journey. And, you know, you're a beautiful inspiration for all of those that are listening tonight. And, you know, because when you lose one child, you think it's not survivable. And so here we have you sharing your journey of surviving not one but two losses on the same day. Mm-hmm. And, you know, harnessing the power of your own tragedy and, you know, creating all these wonderful, you know, grief to peace type tools for people to use. So that's fantastic. Any last words for any parents whose, you know, child has died that you want to pass on to them?
You know, that's such... Cherish the moments. Remember, don't forget your child. And if your family is tired of hearing about it, find a new group of people to vocalize your thoughts and your feelings. And don't put them to rest in your memory, because they are forever in your hearts. The love never dies. The laughter will remain. That's what I know for sure is love never dies.
Right. Absolutely true.
Beautiful.
Beautifully said. Well, the best of luck to you, you know, in all your endeavors. We look forward to watching
so
your movie come
to
out.
Meet you.
And
yes.
Yeah. Your demeanor, everything about you is joyous, and that is such a breath of fresh air. That is very beautiful.
It sure is.
You know, very beautiful. So if you would like to contact Angela, her website is miraclesinaction.com. She also has a website, miraclesinactionfilm.com. Look for her documentary to come out on the big screen at some point this year, hopefully. And you can reach her on Facebook at Angela Taze Alexander, and I'm going to spell that, Angela Taze, T as in Tom, A-Y-E-S, Alexander. She's on Twitter at Miracles, the letter N for Nancy, Action. So it's Twitter at Miracles, N Action. And her email is miracleinaction@yahoo.com. And thanks so much for joining us tonight, Angela. It's been an honor to have you on here sharing your story. And, you know, you're a beautiful testament to the, you know, surviving such terrible darkness. Mm-hmm. And truly, really, you know, lovely person that you are. And a beautiful, beautiful testament to, you know, surviving the journey. So thank you so much for joining us tonight, everyone. Next week on Grief Diaries Radio is Tanya Brown, the youngest sister of Nicole Brown Simpson, who openly shares her struggles in the aftermath of her sister's high-profile murder almost 21 years ago. So join us next week, same place, same time, right here on Grief Diaries Radio. Have a wonderful week, everyone. Good night.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.
The Grief Diaries Radio Show is brought to you by Alley Blue Media and Good Grief Worldwide, an official partner of National Grief Awareness Day, working to bring grief out of the darkness into the light. For more information about Grief Diaries or to listen to archived episodes, please visit www.griefdiaries.com.